All right, I think we are just about ready to get started. Before I begin, can everyone hear me all right? Can you see the screen? You're probably all muted, but feel free to use the chat feature. All right, perfect. All right, today we are going over software assets and some of the more tricky software assets dealing with contracts or purchases, licensing, or all of the above, and discussing some methods that we can use to either easily implement them or quickly implement them using all of the information that we have, but in a rather easy way instead of spending a lot of time putting everything into the system. My name is Joy Von Hedrick. I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I've been with Cyrosyn for about a year and a half. They send me on some really interesting asset management engagements, so I get to see quite a few number of environments and set different solutions up for them. Kind of pick and choose different technologies to use for them or different scenarios for any of their assets. So I've got a lot of interesting stuff to show you. For questions during the presentation, feel free to type them into the chat window. We may or may not stop on them, but then we'll definitely come back to them during the end of the presentation. Okay, yep. All right. So let's get started with the agenda. It's essentially a lot of examples that I'll be showing you in different scenarios that have affected different organizations that I've seen, and a lot of questions that I've seen or been asked about software assets or contracts or both, and how to best deal with them. First, we'll go over some normal software assets using them in the portal, then some more complex software assets. Using a little bit of automation to make them work properly. Then we'll discuss some software assets that you don't actually have to track as assets because the information might not be necessary, or you might be able to get it elsewhere, or it just might be so rare that it doesn't make sense to spend time making them into assets. And then we'll discuss some contracts. Use the portal to create some new contracts, see how they update, then move on to some more of the tricky assets and contracts, and how to deal with contracts that you don't necessarily need software assets for, but you still have licenses for. And then we'll move on to hardware assets with contracts that are also a little bit more tricky than they may seem at first glance. And then we can move on to subcontracts and discuss what to do with some of those. And we'll be doing a lot of examples, pretty much all of them using the Cyrosyn portal. We shouldn't have to use the console for any of these items. But yeah, we'll find out. Right, so let's start with some easy software assets. These are some generic examples that you may have in your environment. And let's take a quick look at what you can do in the portal to use them. To implement them or add them. All right, so normally, if you want to add a new software asset in the portal, you could come down to the new drawer, go to Asset Management, Software Asset, Create Software Asset, and we will follow the example from our slide, and let's do TextPad. Give it some basic properties. And this is for if you just want to track how many assets or how many installs of TextPad you have in a very basic manner. You're not really tracking purchases or licenses quite yet. So we'll give it a manual purchase count of 10, or we could even give it an unlimited site license, either or. And we hit apply, and we didn't type in a pattern. So let's do that now. And we end up with our software asset of TextPad. Extremely basic cookie cutter textbook example. And once the software asset sync workflow runs within Service Manager, it will grab this pattern and give us all of the computers that TextPad is installed on, assuming that this is the correct pattern, and then give us an install count that we can do something with. Very, very basic example. Pretty much all of the examples in this list follow that that process. So we're just going to skip the rest of these because they're all too easy. And let's move on to something a little bit harder. Once we start adding licenses or purchases to any of our software assets, it becomes a little bit more tedious as procurement to enter in the data, and a little bit harder to track the data and see whether you have purchases or licenses or to update them, any of that type of stuff. Let's go through a manual example for TextPad. So we just added this example for TextPad, and before we put it as an unlimited site license, but what if that's not true? What if we really need to purchase additional licenses? Well, normally we'd have to go in and create a new license. So we'd come into administration, create new license. And we'll give it a date of today. TextPad. And we'll give it like 10 license or something. And we'll give this purchase 10 seats. And then we will also give it a related software asset of TextPad. So now once we refresh the software asset for TextPad, if we come to the Finance tab and look under Related Licenses, we have an allocated seat count of 10. And then we'd have to come back to the General tab, switch Unlimited Site License off, and then calculate purchase count from license counts because we now have a Related License object, and hit Apply. And we now have a purchase count of 10 for TextPad. And then if we also wanted to add a purchase PO data, purchase order line item data, then we'd have to do the exact same thing where we come in, use the new button on the drawer, go to Asset Management Administration Purchase. And potentially use a purchase order as well, but for this example, we'll just keep a purchase. Center. And we could attach the purchase directly to the software asset. Or we could also attach it directly to the license or both. Now, once we refresh the software asset, we have both a license count as well as a purchase, which you could use for reporting or predicting how much you'll be spending next year, or really any type of purchase, or I'm sorry, any type of reason. But that process, it's a little bit tedious where you have to set up the software asset, the license, and the purchase. And so it's a little bit easier to add some automation to make procurement life a lot easier. One example would be a request offering that does all of that for you. So in my environment, I have a create new software asset request offering. And behind this, we do have a template that's got some manual activities in it, but more importantly, it has some runbook activities that will automatically make a bunch of relationships for you, as well as set properties for you, and or do stuff that you might forget to do. It makes it extremely helpful to do it all in one form in one easy step. In this example, we'll select the purchase object, and you could optionally have it create the purchase object as well, depending on where you get your purchase data from. So we'll select this purchase object. We'll enter in a new unique software name. In this case, we'll do Camtasia. Any version. And we'll give it a number of licenses, say 23, some obscure number. And we'll give the software asset an owner. Optional, this could be an AD group as well, whatever your organization prefers. And then some more optional fields, license keys. We'll just hit submit and see what it does. So initially it creates this new service request. If we open it up and take a look at the activities, it'll have a few different activities. These middle three manual activities will get skipped. And so we'll be left with the first runbook activity and then the fourth runbook activity. So Service Manager will be doing its own thing for about 5 or 7 minutes or so for these two runbooks to finish. And after it's done, we'll end up with a single software asset that has licenses and purchase information all related to each other in a very easy single place. You could go back into this SR and find the software asset on the related items tab, or you could go into any of the items, the software asset, the new Camtasia software asset, the purchase object that we related to it, or the license object that gets created, and find any of the other related items from any of them. It makes it very easy to track any of your purchases or any of your assets and relate them back to each other. Another example is what happens when you need to add new licenses. So you don't need to necessarily create a software asset, but you might just need to add some more licenses. If you do that the normal way, you'd have to open up the software asset, open up the license, or create a new license for the software asset. So we already have this existing license object on the software asset here. And then if we need to add an additional 20 licenses for a total of 30 TextPad licenses, we'd have to come back to the new drawer, go to Asset Management Admin License, and add 20 more licenses. And then relate it back to our software asset again. So it's very doable, but it's a little bit tedious if you have to do this a lot. And then we hit apply, we refresh the software asset TextPad page. We scroll down, we now have a total of 30 licenses. If you click on the general tab, there we go. So now we have a total of 30 purchase count on the software asset. We still don't have purchase information for the second license that we added. So then if we wanted to track that, we'd have to add it again manually. It's a little bit tedious. So let's add some automation to it to make it a lot easier for procurement to do. We'll come over to our home tab and use the update software asset with existing purchases request offering. find our. Oh, that hasn't updated yet. Probably because I have not hit the apply button. Yep, there we go. We'll select text pad. We'll select any given purchase object, line item object. We'll select the cost center if needed, and then enter in the new number of licenses that this purchase uses. We could also add some additional automation if we scroll up and we select the purchase item. It does have a unit count, and so we could easily force it to be 8 for the number of licenses that we purchase if your line item counts in your organization contains that type of information. So we will add 35 new licenses to TextPad. Hit the submit button. And it will create a new service request. It's probably still thinking a little bit. Let's refresh the other one. Right, so this one is still in progress. It finished the first runbook, but it's still on the second one. It'll probably need another couple of minutes to finish that one, which is fine. We'll come back to that in a little bit. I do want to start. Give me one moment. Okay. All right. The next item, so we've just used request offering to add additional purchase and license info. What happens if we don't necessarily need to add new info, new license info, but we might need to remove some licenses? For example, it's a yearly true up or yearly consolidation of licenses, and you're not necessarily making a purchase, you're decreasing counts or rearranging counts, redistributing counts, something like that. You might want to remove some licenses, but you still want to keep the license info historically so that you know what you've purchased, what licenses previously affected a software asset. That's very easy to do with some automation. Slightly tedious if we do it manually. Let's take a look at what happens if we do it manually. So normally on the TextPad software asset, if we take a look at the licenses, they are all active and current. If we want to change that and keep a history of these, we can change the status from current to expired, or set the license type to temporary and force expire them. And it'll keep the licenses related to this software asset, but it will make them no longer count towards the total purchase count of the software asset. So let's take a look at what that looks like. So let's refresh this page, and then we can change the license type to temporary, give it an expiration date of yesterday, and then hit apply. And now, once we come back to the software asset and refresh the software asset page, the finance tab now has an expired license here. And so, if we look on the general tab, we should have a count, yes, of 10. So, what this means is that if we have a, let's go back to the finance tab. If we have a long list of licenses, for example, you've been making purchases all year or for the last 5 years, a really good example of this would be Snagit. Every now and then you get a few additional purchases, a few additional users, and so you might, over the course of 2 or 3 years, have 50 purchases. Well, then you decide to just buy one single purchase of Snagit for the current version with current support and maintenance. And you just have one set of license keys or one license key, which I'm not actually sure if like Snagit will do one license key, but they do true ups of that sort where you can buy a single instance for current software. And you might want to just expire all of your previous licenses. You can do that with this method. Except if you have 50 different purchases or 50 different licenses, that's really tedious to go through all 50 of them. So let's add a little bit of automation to that to make it a little bit more interesting. If we come to the Home tab, we can use a request offering for reconcile license counts. And in this case, let's go ahead and pick on TextPad again. So right now we have a total purchase count of 30. I probably have not updated this page because that should be 10. It's 10. Let's hit apply. Then we'll refresh this page. Yep, there we go. Now it's back down to 10, which is exactly what we want. And now we'll enter in the new number of seats. And we'll give it a total count of 13. And so what this will do is automatically retire or automatically expire all licenses on TextPad and then add one new license object to TextPad with a total of 13 licenses, 13 seats. And that makes it extremely easy for procurement to update license data, update software data with using a single form without having to switch back and forth between different forms and wondering if they correctly made a relationship or not. And all of this is all customizable, so it could be easily tailored to literally any environment. Let's take a look at the first SR that we had for creating Camtasia. It says that it's now completed. So hopefully we have a new software asset called Camtasia with a total of 23 licenses using this purchase number that cost this amount. So if I, as the procurement user, go into my requests, I could see that I've got this request that's completed for Camtasia within a few minutes after I put it in, and I could verify everything. And to do that, I could click on the Related Items tab, see that I have both a license and the software asset related to this service request. I could click on Camtasia, take a look at the Finance tab, see that we've got the cost center, the purchase order that was related to the purchase item, and that we have a license object that was newly created that has 23 seats. So we have all of the information that we entered into the request offering in a nice, easy web of relationships. It looks really pretty. I think so anyway. If we take a look down at the purchase count, we probably have to apply it and update it. Normally you'll have the software asset sync workflow running in the background. Are also going to open up the license object because it also has a workflow that runs. And I just want to make sure that the purchase count does indeed move up to 23, which I'm pretty sure it will right now. Yep, there we go. All right, yeah, perfect. So yeah, it makes it extremely easy to just enter in all the information in one simple step. All right, let's move on to irrelevant software assets. So we've talked about some easy cookie cutter examples, but sometimes you don't want to use software assets because it's more work to enter them in than what you get out of it. For example, some organizations, they might have a site license for Windows, or rather a large number of Microsoft products, an enterprise license for a large number of Microsoft products. And so Windows specifically, you'll pretty much only install it on physical machines or virtual machines, both of which you can get a very easy count of the number of machines in your environment without tracking Windows as the software. So in that case, do you really need to create a software asset for Windows? Some organizations, yes, but some organizations, no. You can easily pull the info from Configuration Manager or some other location. There are a lot of assets that fall under the realm of not really caring about the number of installs, but you might want to see them every now and then, the number of installs every now and then, and that's a gray area. But for the most part, if it takes you more time to set up and manage the software asset than it does to grab the information, and there's no real reason to create a software asset, then there's no, I would say don't do it. It's not worth your time. Some more common examples where you don't want to create software assets would be key server usage. So AutoCAD, for one example, you'll have a key server that lets you use 15 concurrent licenses or 15 concurrent uses of AutoCAD. And if you create a software asset out of it, then you might have AutoCAD installed on 50 computers. And so Service Manager will be telling you that you have 50 computers installed, but only 15 licenses, and it'll look like you're out of compliance, when in actuality you have a key server that's telling you, or that's managing your licenses for you. There's a different scenario here where you might have both a key server and device installs. And that's a little bit harder to track, where you have 15 concurrent licenses that the key server is letting you use, and then you also have an additional 15 or 20 device licenses. For that one, you'll probably want to use a combination of software metering to know the users that are using it, or have the key server tell you the computers that are using it, and mix and match those with the SCCM data or Service Manager data that you get back to get an accurate count. This scenario, it's not too common, but it does happen. And you might need to account for it in your organization. Another example of software assets that you might not want to track would be cloud-based software, cloud-based licensing that may not necessarily have software. Salesforce does have software, like a really terrible Outlook plugin from 2007. You can't really count that in software asset management because it's too terrible to count. Any type of cloud-based licensing software doesn't really work too well with software asset management because you can't easily count it. There might be some tricks that you can do, maybe use an API that gets the number of users that are logging into your portal, your site. But for the most part, it's usually easier to manage these using the cloud software itself. And so it doesn't make too much sense to create a software asset when there's nothing really to track, there's no software pattern. This is more of a contract type item than a software item, which we'll get into a little bit later. And lastly, software assets that you'll never be asked about, like freeware. You might want to track something like Notepad++. It's optional, but for the most part, there's no real need to. All right, let's move on to contracts. And we'll go through a couple easy examples, and then move on to some more complex examples. Let's start with, so all of these top four are kind of common. You've probably seen all of these before. Something that is not quite as common as a contract object are certificates. So an SSL cert or a domain, it's not technically a contract, quote unquote, but it does follow all of the rules of a contract, which is something that has a scheduled recurring end date and a purchase that must occur in order to renew it. So that kind of makes it fall into the realm of contracts. Let's go ahead and create one and see what that looks like. So normally you would come in if you want to create it manually from the drawer. And we'll create a new domain. We'll call it and we'll give it a start date and an end date. And that's new contract. Very easy to create. It doesn't really have any purchase info on it quite yet, but that's completely fine. Sometimes you might not want purchase info on your contract because you might track it elsewhere, like a financial system, but sometimes you do. And so, in order to add a purchase to your contract, you could go in through the new drawer. Actually, let's create a new. And this will be identical to what we did for the software asset and/or licenses, where we add a new purchase. And now we have both a contract and a purchase. But sometimes we might want something a little bit more complex. So let's take a look at some more complex examples. And you could also create a request offering for contracts, which do I don't think I actually have one in this demo. I do, but we'll come back to that one for one of these examples. All right, so sometimes you might get a contract and you aren't quite sure what to do with it. Yeah, there's a lot of different options and they vary per organization. Let's discuss the first one, for example, Snagit. So it's a piece of software, you install it, you track it with SECM, and you can create a software asset from it. However, they also have support and maintenance so that you can upgrade to the latest versions, get some patches, get some assistance if needed. And you pay yearly for that, or you pay on a schedule for that. So that's technically a contract as well. So how do you enter this in into asset management? At first glance, you could say just do one or the other, or do both. But it kind of depends on what your organization is looking to do with it. So if you have a small number of users, say 5 or 10 Snagit users, and you know that you're going to renew the contract every year, and you're not really interested in tracking how many users have it installed, because you only take a look once per year and you know that it's always going to be around 10 somewhere, maybe 11, maybe 9, then it doesn't make too much sense to create a software asset. And you could, it would be another item that you have to look at and manage, which is completely fine. But the overall impact of that is going to be minimal as a software asset. You know that you're going to renew the contract every year, so it makes a little bit more sense to create a contract for it. And then either have a notice event or something like that telling you that you have to renew it and you'll have the anticipated cost. Rosetta Stone, very similar, as a subscription, that is. You can decide if you have a small number of users that if you want to create a software asset for it, sure you can. Subscription, it's more of a contract, so probably definitely create a contract or something like that. If you have a large number of users and the number varies a little bit more, then you might want to consider making a software asset just for the automatic tracking and the ease of use. You can very easily see if you have 500 users or 550 users, if it varies that much. It depends entirely on what your organization wants to do with software assets. Let's talk about a more interesting contract that pretty much every organization has, the EA agreement. So you'll get a giant list of software from Microsoft, or a giant Excel spreadsheet from Microsoft, listing all of your Microsoft products, or most of them. And the Microsoft EA agreement itself is one contract, or in some cases two or four contracts, or if you have multiple departments or companies or organizations within your organization, you might have one per organization, one per company, which is fine. It'll be a small number of contracts, but the number of software titles is going to be kind of large. Let's take a look at an example that I have for an EA agreement. So you might get a file that looks something like this, and it's got a bunch of random software on it, all Microsoft products, but you don't know if you should enter these in as software assets, or should you ignore them, or what do you do with the license counts? It's not very clear. You might have to guess. Well, here's a good starting point. You take the file, and then you grab the unique list of software titles or software assets that you might want to make into software assets. So we're going to copy this to a new sheet and show you what this looks like quickly, and it might give you a good idea of what you might want to do once you get a giant file that doesn't make a lot of sense like this one. First we'll sort and filter, and then we might do something like take column A, give it a new sheet again, paste it, remove some duplicates, and that gets us 45 unique items. These are all duplicates still, despite the license counts. So then you go through each individual one and decide if you want to track it as a software asset or not. A lot of these you can completely ignore. Like Advanced Threat Analytics Client Management License. I'm not actually sure what that is. Maybe someone else knows and they want to track it as a software asset. Me personally, I would say no. This is probably installed on, one server in a closet somewhere. Then we might need the license, but we don't really need to track it as a software asset. Something a little bit more common, like let's go with Link, let's go with Office. That one's a pretty standard one. This one we'll probably want to track Office. We might not necessarily want to track Project Server. We might only have a small handful of SharePoint servers. So if we track this, we might get a total of two or three or four in our organization. If we have a lot more, then we might want to track it. But otherwise, we could probably just not create a software asset and leave it as a contract only, the contract being the Microsoft EA agreement. So when you create the contract for Microsoft EA, you'll want to attach a bunch of documents to the contract itself so that you do know in the future all the different software titles that you are entitled to. And you could go back to the contract at any point in time to make sure that you are in compliance if needed. But otherwise, creating all of these software assets themselves, it's not really productive. You can spend countless hours making each of these into a software asset, making sure that the counts are correct, but you'll never actually need the data. You'll never use it in a report. You'll never use it for auditing purposes. It just doesn't make much sense to track every single software asset. After we go through this list, or after you would then go through this list, you could make each individual one a software asset. If they don't already exist as software assets, then that process can be a little bit tedious because you'd have to create a new software asset 35 times, or however many software assets that you want to track. We do have a software hydration kit if you are first starting out, which will give you a large number of really common software assets to put in your organization, and then you can just pick and choose and delete the ones that you don't use. But for some of the more obscure titles, yep, you'll have to create them one at a time, or multiple at a time if you use something like Asset Excel. It'll be a somewhat manual process in either case. There are some other interesting contracts that we can look at as well. So sometimes you might get a contract that is for support, and it'll come with licenses attached to it. For example, Nuance PDF Converter has 500 licenses. Well, this is technically a software asset, even though the quote that you receive doesn't really look or act or say software anywhere on it. And so you're given the choice of using this as a software asset or just as a contract. So if you know that your organization has 400 users, but Nuance PDF Converter only has packages of 1 to 399 users or 400 to 500 users, and so you go with the 500 license option, and you know that your organization does not currently have more than 500 people, then it doesn't really make much sense to use a software asset for PDF Converter. If you think that you might be able to decrease the number of licenses by doing so, then yes, absolutely. But sometimes that's just not the case, and so you might want to only use this as a contract and not as a software asset. At any point in time, you could always create an additional software asset for it, just to count the number of licenses or see if you can decrease it, if you think that you might have to. But otherwise, when you're first creating these, then it's a lot easier to just create the contract and worry about the software later, because you'll always have the contract that you can come back to, and you'll pretty much always need a contract if it's going to be renewed at some point in time on a schedule. The same is true for other similar examples where you have 100 users for I don't want to call it a cloud kind of license. It's more of a not really a concurrent user license either, but something that you have on site that you only have a number of users or uses of. You still wouldn't really create a software asset for that. It's still better to create a contract generally, unless you need the tracking for a specific reason. Right. Okay, let's take a look at some more contracts. And some of the more interesting contracts. Scratch that. Let's, forgot to show you the create contract request offering. So this one will add some automation near identical to what software assets did, where you get to select your purchase object, your contract type, your new contract name, and some other generic items in your contract. And after about 3 or 4 minutes, this new contract will be created, just like we did with the new drawer, except it also includes the purchase object and includes the relationship for it. All right, let's talk about some other contracts. One's mostly dealing with hardware, but more importantly, contracts that you might not be sure what to do with because they're just so weird and the vendors send you some really bizarre data. So it's hard to get a starting point on what you might want to do with them. So solar winds, for example, you might have a single contract, but it might have a bunch of hardware assets associated with it. And so you then create the contract and then also create the hardware assets and then relate the two, or do you just create the do you just create the contract because you might not necessarily need the hardware assets unless you have the contract, so it might be a little bit redundant. It entirely depends on what your organization's looking for. Generally, I like to say if it's got a serial number and you might want to track it, then create a hardware asset for it. But only if you have someone that can manage it and find out where it is, what happened to it, where it came from, that type of stuff. For appliances, so the second bullet point for a Netezza appliance install. So this is still a physical box. It's a physical server that arrives, or a physical appliance that arrives, and you place it somewhere, for example, the data center. But then you only really use it if you also have subscription and support. And that's a renewal. That's the exact same thing as the first one, where you create the contract for it because you're always going to be renewing the contract. And you still have the hardware that you have to track as well. So for this one, yes, create both. Unless you think that it'll just be more work to create the hardware asset. You'll pretty much always want to create the contract for this. But the hardware asset has a small chance to be optional. You'll probably want to create it anyway. How about some more tricky items? So a physical device with multiple software items or drivers or components. So you might get a physical device that only works with certain additional software from the vendor. And you have to pay for each of those software items. And I don't have any actual examples that I'm able to show you in this presentation, but I've seen a couple companies have this type of issue where they don't know how to track the contract or the hardware asset or what they should do with all the components. What you could do, probably a not recommended option, is create the hardware asset and then create additional config items for any of the configurations for the hardware asset. So you might have an additional 12 line items for the drivers or for the components or for the proprietary pieces of hardware that come with that server or the physical device. But then you'd have to track all of those, and that's really tedious. No one really wants to do that unless you have a business reason for doing so. For something like that, you could very easily create one single hardware asset with the purchase data, the purchase order that you have for it that contains all the items, and relate that purchase order via PDF file or attached file to the hardware asset or to the contract, possibly both. And this is assuming that it's a rather rare scenario, which it usually is. And it makes a lot more sense on the procurement side to not have to deal with these really random, odd items that come with your hardware asset or that come with your contract. But it still gives you reliability. Like anyone in procurement or anyone on the hardware asset team in who deals with asset management can open up the hardware asset or the contract and view the related file to see if they need to do something with the contract. If this is a common occurrence where you constantly have to open up the item and view the PDF file, and that becomes a lot of manual work, and you might want that data more visible. So at that point, your organization might want to think about making them different components or different configuration items that you can look at or search on or filter or track. But that's extremely rare that that's the case. How about multiple hardware assets with different contracts? So in this example, I've got printers. Let's take a look at my list of printers. So in this example, I've got a few different Canon ImageRunner printers. And in my organization, all of these are covered under a contract from Canon. And so if anything happens before the end date for any of these items, then Canon will come out and fix it for me. Unfortunately, all of these have different end dates, and so I can't really create a single contract because one contract can only have one end date. So what do we do? Well, we have a couple options. As procurement, if I know that all of my printers are covered in every scenario, then we could, instead of using a contract, make a single warranty item and apply that warranty to all of the hardware assets. And the warranty item would be a master warranty item that has a span of 3 years. And we could just apply that to each hardware asset, and so it would be covered for the hardware asset's 3-year life cycle, or however long the warranty or contract is good for. In some organizations, that's not possible, because you might have an additional warranty in addition to the contract, and so you can't have two warranties on a software item. But that's not necessarily common for items like printers or servers or high dollar items, because they always have an implied warranty that is not nearly as important as the contract, which is usually almost always on high dollar items. So if you have a warranty, you could just create one single object instead of creating multiple contract objects to deal with this type of scenario. The other option, since we have one single contract that corresponds to multiple items, we might just have to create different items, different subcontracts. Looking at the last example, we'll take a look at SmartNet. And let's pull up that. So in this example, we've got a few Blade servers, and they all have a unique serial number, and they have different end dates. So for this one, even though we have the exact same contract number, we could call in, give them this contract number, and then say that we need help with any one of these servers, except they may or may not cover it depending on what the coverage end date is. As procurement, we can't really rely on that because it's not consistent. We need to do something else. For example, we might need to know when something is going to expire so that we can re-up the contract. And we can't just give it a generic end date because that's not good enough. So in that case, we'll probably want to create different contracts, different subcontracts. And I call them subcontracts because that's the most common term, but a subcontract is still a regular contract, and it follows all the rules of a regular contract, and so there's no real getting around it. We're going to have to create a contract for any subcontract that has different rules that it has to follow. So in our case, we want to create a different contract for each end date using this same contract number. So we'd want to do something like new contract name. And normally we would just want a SmartNet renewal contract with this contract number, but now we have to differentiate between the different end dates, and so we can do something like ending in, or I guess ending on might be better. And we'll give it this end date, which doesn't like my formatting, because I'm forgetting the last ampersand, and it doesn't like the, or however you would convert. Yeah, I probably should have practiced my Excel beforehand. So like a to date. Switch that to text, maybe. Nope, doesn't like that. We'll just do one of these.
There we go.
Except it still doesn't like that, because it's got a 4. Something like that. And then we could take this list, give it a new sheet, remove the duplicates, and we'll probably get 2 examples, yeah. And then we would create 2 different contracts and relate all of our hardware assets to these 2 contracts. Let's say we want to do that easily and or quickly. Normally, we'd have to come into the portal, go to the new drawer, go to contract, and create a support contract from here, and then manually relate all of our assets. That's kind of tedious. Instead, we could use a little bit of automation. And do a bulk add hardware assets to contract. And we could select any given contract and then grab a list of serial numbers. We sort, for example. Or probably sort by new contract name. And then grab all of these, paste these serial numbers into the request offering form, and it will automatically match these up with hardware assets if one exact match is found based on the serial number, and it will automatically relate or create new hardware assets based on that info, based on whatever automation that you have set up for it to do. That makes it extremely easy for procurement to get a list of serial numbers from any vendor and relate them to a contract, and or unrelate old assets from a contract, and let you know if you have something out of compliance or something like that.